So, hey everyone, welcome to our new setup here. This is the 199th meeting of the New York Linux Users Group. That means the next one will be the 200th, I believe. According to our counts, we may have slid one way or the other behind, but we'll call it. We'll be right here with all of you, and we'll be doing something fun. I'll get to that in a minute, or hearing about something fun. Anyway, this is the latest of our regular monthly meetings. Tonight we are going to be hearing from Daniel Walsh to answer a question that a lot of people ask when they get into containers a little bit, which is how to make containers actually contain, and probably putting some framing on that and asking the right questions and getting the right answers, hopefully, not to speak out of turn here, but hopefully. I'd like to say, as usual, but very much from the heart, how much we appreciate Bloomberg for sponsoring us in this space, and we want to say thank you to everyone who's here for coming out to join us. Your being here is an integral part of making this happen. Without you, we wouldn't be able to do this. Tonight, before we get started, we have our usual requests. Silence your cell phones. Do not eat snacks that are in noisy wrappers. If you have to, find a way to put it in a non-noisy thing. And please use the microphones for questions at the end. We're going to hold questions until the end, and we will ask people to line up and alternate. We have that all set up this time. Our next regular meeting will feature Guy Lenardi with a talk titled Debian to Brewmaster, The Alchemy of Building SteamOS. And that will be here again on Wednesday, November 18th. If you're interested, RSVP should be opening soon. I'd like to thank again our regular space sponsor, Bloomberg, and acknowledge our other sponsors, past and present. These include IBM, Canonical, Brandor Group, Google, and O'Reilly Media for all of their past support and occasional ongoing support, too. In addition, NYLUG would not be able to function without our many volunteers who you see at the entrance and you see helping out at the workshop and other such things. We appreciate their contributions and we run on them. So, announcements. We have our regular workshop announcement. Please talk to Hannah or Rob and David also. Sorry, David, I didn't have your name on here initially. But if you're interested in the workshop, just talk to them afterwards. The workshops are at the City College at 138th Street in Amsterdam. The next workshop will be Tuesday, October 20th, I believe, from 6 to 8 p.m., and it will appear on the Meetup page very soon. In case you missed it, you can grab a Linux distro DVD from the table the back to all of you, but the front of the office. Yep. Oh, that's right. It's on the windowsill today. They're free for you to use and yours to keep. It's for you to try out a distro if you had an interest in one but hadn't had time to download it or set it up for yourself. And in addition, for this talk, Daniel has brought with him and his colleagues a bunch of SELinux coloring books, right?
Not only, there's also container coloring books.
Ooh.
So we're
going to
cover that.
So those are yours to grab. So if you can on the way out or on the way by, definitely pick one up for yourself. It will be material from the talk. Does anyone else here have any announcements, events that are upcoming, anything they would like to make better known? Anybody? All right, not this week. In that case, note that at the end of the presentation, there will be trivia questions asked by Daniel with material from the presentation. The prizes will be the books, the ebook vouchers, or we have a couple of vouchers for some Docker video tutorials from, I believe, Wiley? Not Wiley. Whoops, I'll probably get in trouble for that sometime. InformIT.com. And so those will be up for grabs for whoever can answer the questions. If you have more than six questions, we have more than six giveaways, so people can take them all. It's up to you. But you're not on the hook for that. That's if.
About two questions right now.
If. Two people will win that. But anyway, we'll get to that at the end. So please welcome Daniel Walsh with How to Make Containers Actually Contain, everybody. Thank you.
Okay, can everybody hear me? Okay, the SELinux coloring book and the container coloring book, has everybody got a copy? I only brought as many as could fit in my luggage, and my wife is sitting in the back, so this is gonna be a weird experience because she's never seen me talk before. So we'll try to behave myself. And she did comment that I brought a bigger bag with me on this trip than she did, so but my bag was full of coloring books. So the coloring book is actually the textbook for this talk, okay? So last year we did the SELinux coloring book, this year we did the container coloring book. And the container coloring book is really focused on security, okay? Security, what to consider when you're going to a Docker environment or to a container environment. It's not just, we're gonna cover multiple topics here, not just the topic about container separation, although the bulk of the talk's gonna be around container separation. But I just want you guys to think about certain things. So container security, as explained by the three pigs. So if you have the coloring book is based on the three pigs, and we're gonna go over the idea of the three pigs in this. So container security, chapter one is gonna talk about where should the pigs or the containers, you know, when should you use, we're gonna cover when should you use containers versus virtualization. So it's probably the number one question when we, over the last couple of years, has been, you know, why containers versus virtualization? What are the benefits and what are the costs and when to use them? We're also gonna cover what platform should you choose to run your containers on? And then we're gonna choose how to container separation. How do you separate the containers? How do you make sure that the containers don't attack each other or attack the host? And then lastly, and this is, might be the most important thing, is how do I contain the information? How do we pick the information, the tools that I run inside of the container from a security point of view? So the coloring book is covering, talks about the three pigs, and the glossary is basically a pig equals an application. But actually a pig equals a service that's running inside of an application. So we're gonna, the analogy is gonna be, if you ran a multi-service application suite inside of Docker, you'd be basically looking at, say, one pig is your web's front end and another pig is your database. So how do I keep those pigs separated from each other? So chapter one, what we wanna look at is where should the pigs live? So this is really trying to figure out where you're gonna run your services. From a security point of view, when we run services, the most secure platform you can run a service on is to run each service on a different physical piece of hardware. Okay, that is the most secure. That's the way we always used to run applications, right? We always used to isolate applications based on physical hardware. If one of these pigs gets attacked by the big bad wolf, do I have to fix all the other houses? Okay, that analogy there would be the same as if one machine inside of your environment gets hacked, do you have to reinstall all the machines inside of your environment? No. Or at least you don't, you know, we think you don't have to, right? So everybody in this room has probably been hacked at one point, or your company's been hacked at one point. So if your services are running on different physical hardware, we believe that the ability to attack one system does not mean that the other systems get compromised. So when we move away from that, we move to virtualization. So virtualization is sort of like living in a duplex, okay, where you have some shared resources, but it's very limited shared environment between it. And so virtualization is the second most secure way to run your application. So if you ran one application on one machine and another application on another, and the VMs get hacked, then the applications are still separate. There are interesting attacks, and KVM, libvirt KVM has been broken out of. There's been two known attack sources for breaking out of KVM and getting to the host system. Both of those, by the way, have been blocked by SELinux. So SELinux, SVirt, has actually prevented escalation of what's called a hypervisor vulnerability. But we've been doing pretty good security on virtualization for a number of years now, and it's shown to be very, very secure. When we move to containers now, containers are sort of like living in a hotel or living in an apartment building. Okay, the reason the analogy works here is in an apartment building or in a hotel, the single point of failure for the entire facility is the front desk. And in a container environment, the single point of failure is the kernel. All the processes on the system are talking to the kernel. If the kernel has a vulnerability, I can break out of my container and take over the host, and therefore take over the other containers. So similar to, in a apartment building, I want to attack the front desk. Is that good or bad? All right, so when we look at containers, we have to understand that traditionally we've been running multiple services on the same machine at the same time. So containers are actually more secure than running the traditional way that a lot of people run applications. You run your database and maybe your front end on the same machine, same time, or the same virtual machine. So I call that as like living in a hostel. So it's basically, you know, if you have a privileged process in one and a privileged process living on another, you know, you have potentially a little bit of security between them. And of course, you know, you have SELinux to protect you, but you have very little security between your pigs. So it's like pigs living in a hostel. And then, of course, we get to the people. Anybody here disable SELinux? Okay, that's pigs sleeping in the park, okay? So 740, pigs sleeping in the park, and then we go, has everybody been to this website? So this is stopdisablingselinux.com. Okay, so this was actually designed by Major Hayden, who's he's in charge of security at Rackspace. So he put this up a couple of years. So every time you guys said in 4-0, you know that I'm crying a little bit inside, okay? So from a security point of view, we went down the list of security, but there's other things that you have to take into account when you're going to run your processes, services on it. And it turns out the containers have a great ability of resource sharing and be able to take more advantage of the CPUs, things like that on the system. So in a lot of ways, living in an apartment building or running your processes inside of a container tends to be a sort of a sweet spot. So what I've been working on since I've started working on Docker the last couple of years is to how to make the living in an apartment building or living in a container a bit easier. So we're going to choose to look deeper into what it means to live in an apartment. So if I'm going to live in an apartment building, what's the most important thing when I choose an apartment building? Right? You want to look at the quality of the apartment building. You want to look at the quality of the host that you're going to run your service on. Best combination resource sharing. So now we're going to get into the traditional three pig story. The house made out of straw. Okay, running containers on your own homegrown platform is basically what I would analogize to the house of straw. Because most people that are building their own homegrown container platforms are not that concerned about security. But they're not really following, they're not tied into the whole CVE process, they're not tied into the security response teams. So you basically, these people tend to throw these things together. Think boot to Docker, for instance. Other types, you just want to throw up the container environment and run it, and you sort of built it yourself, but did you enable SELinux? Did you enable some of this new security features? Are you watching for kernel vulnerabilities? Are you updating on a regular basis? Probably not. So it's really looking at that as sort of the house of straw. So next level up, if you choose to run your containers on a house made of sticks, the analogy here is this is basically you running your containers on a community platform. All right? Think about, when we talk about containers, what is the most important thing about containers? If the most important thing about the containers is that they all share the same kernel, the kernel becomes the most important thing. All right? The security of that kernel is critical. Is that kernel up to date? Does it have a response, a security team that's watching out for vulnerabilities in the kernel? Do you get regular updates? Do you get regular security? In a community base, communities do the best job they can for doing this, but they tend to expire quickly, not necessarily have rapid fixes, things like that. But a community platform is pretty good, but then we get down to my sales pitch. The house made out of brick. Okay? And that is running containers on RHEL. Is anybody shocked? Anybody surprised? Okay. Right. I'm within 10 years of retirement. I want you guys buying RHEL, okay? I need a job for 10 years. But really, if you think about it, you know, the kernel is the most important thing. So all you people that are going out and buying random distributions and random things that do not have a kernel support architecture for running your containers, you're just taking a huge chance. All right, Red Hat has approximately, I guess, around 200 kernel engineers in different departments. So we have kernel engineers that look in performance. How do we run these containers fast? How do I set up security? I have a security response team watching for vulnerabilities. We pour all this money into make sure that the Linux kernel is up to date, is, you know, as secure as possible. So as you take these containers, you're going to build services, and then you're going to run these services over a number of years. All right, we're not going to, you know, everybody right now is not going to be in DevOps model forever where you're just throwing together these applications and you're running them. You're going to run it over a number of years. So you need to have a kernel in an operating system that's behind it, the base operating system that has a support cycle around it. So think about these things. Think about what you're going to be running this environment about. What happens if there's a security vulnerability? You're going to lose everything. Rel maintenance, nice looking pig there. Security response team. And now we're going to go into the topic that we've all been waiting for is, how do I separate my pigs in the apartment? How do I, if one apartment gets compromised, what is the security wrapper around it? So when I first started talking about containers, anybody see me at DockerCon a couple of years ago? All right, yeah. At DockerCon, I put up a slide similar to this, and I basically said containers don't contain. All right, so the basic idea is you're running a root process inside of a container. Right? But by default, you're running a root process. Even if you're not running root inside of the container, you have a process, potential hostile process running in your system, and I would call that a local exploit. Okay, if you looked over the years in security, there was always worried about the remote exploit versus the local exploit. If I already have a process running on your machine and talking to the kernel, I've already got the local exploit. All right, so the only thing I have to do after I got a local exploit is figure out a way to get a root exploit and take over all the system. And in a lot of cases, we run our containers as root on the system. So my question to all of you is, do you care? Is there a reason to care about the security of the containers? And really what I'm saying here is, remember when we went back to the pigs, you know, where should you choose to leave the pigs? If you traditionally ran your services, multiple services on the same machine at the same time, containers are more secure. But what I fear when people go to containers is they start to treat containers like it's some kind of magic sauce that's going to contain my process, that I can go out and run random untrusted stuff on my box and not take the good security mechanisms that I've developed over the years to run my containers. Things like drop privileges as fast as possible. You don't want to run root privileges for a real long time inside your container. You don't want to, just because you're running in a container, don't run your Apache server as root. Treat root within the container the same way as root outside of the container. I've been contacted, I work a lot with government certification bureaus, and they are all asking me, how do I certify, you know, containers, right? They're certified virtualization, they're certified operating system, and I always tell them, we got to treat root as inside the container as root outside the container. I'm not willing to take any chances outside of that, right? If I'm going to be led off to jail in handcuffs, I'm not going to tell you that the containers are secure. So we have to treat it like that. And as long as you go in with that mentality, the same mentality you would if you were just running an Apache server on there, then your containers actually are more secure than probably what you're doing right now. I usually say this as an engineer from Red Hat, but since that engineer is here right now, Simo Source, where are you? Okay, Simo actually had this quote, and I've actually cleaned it up a little bit. You can imagine which word I'm actually saying. So Simo said, Docker is all about running random crap from the internet as root on the system, except he didn't say the word crap, hard to believe. So really, people right now are going out and just grabbing random code from the internet and put it in, and then they run it as root. All right, so think about that. That's what you're doing when you're running this content, this stuff that you're doing on here is running. And so you guys have this magic belief that if I run it inside of a container, I can suddenly do really stupid things. So only run containers from trusted parties. The same thing you've been doing. If you're getting source code from a trusted party, then run it. If you're getting it from Fred's website, don't run it. Okay? Don't go to hackme.com and do a Docker pull from it. So why don't containers contain? The number one reason is everything in Linux is not namespaced. So everybody, I've done lots and lots of talks in the past talking about containers. Containers really involves three parts of the Linux kernel. So Docker is all about establishing the container, putting your user space in place, and then instrumenting the Linux kernel to enable namespaces, C groups, and security mechanisms. Okay, at that point, Docker really gets away out of the way and just becomes a route for standard in, standard out, just basically routing that back to the client. But that's really all that's happening with containers. But containers are taking advantage of namespaces. So namespaces right now, there's five namespaces that are enabled in Docker. So whether it's on RHEL or Ubuntu or any other operating system, there's five namespaces that are taking advantage. The problem is lots of the operating system is not namespaced. For example, containers are not comprehensive. If you had everything namespaced, that would be called KVM. All right, that's all about, you know, if I basically virtualize the entire kernel, that's KVM. But we're taking sort of a shortcut here, and we're only taking a few namespaces. So things like the kernel file system, slash sys, slash procsys, slash sysfs, things like SELinux, they're not namespaces, cgroups, devmapper, kernel modules, all that stuff's not namespaced. Okay, so because that's not namespaced, the kernel, we have to play games. We have to try to protect the kernel. So from the rest of the talk, we're going to be talking about the security of the kernel. Okay, really what we're talking about when we're trying to secure a Docker container is basically limiting the attack surface on the kernel. Again, everybody shares the kernel. So we want to stop processes, even privileged processes inside of the container, from doing certain activities on the kernel. And now I'm going to go through how we're doing that. So the first thing you have to understand is we actually mount a lot of file systems into the Docker container as read-only mount points. Things like slash sys, slash procsys. Basically, these are kernel file systems. And one of the ways a process interacts with the kernel is through a kernel file system. It'd be really nice if we didn't have to put these into the container at all, but a lot of processes rely on these, the information here. The good thing, though, is if these things are read-only, then the processes are very well run. They run very well. Most processes don't need to write to these, or most services applications don't need to write to these kernel file systems, so we can mount them read-only into the kernel. Of course, a privileged process has the ability to remount a file system, right? So now we've mounted certain things in it, but what we want to do is we want to ensure that the kernel process, the privileged process, root inside the kernel, cannot do mount. All right, if I can mount, I can break out of anything, okay? So if I have the ability to mount, that's, as a matter of fact, anybody that's played with user namespace, all the vulnerabilities up to this point in user namespace have been around allowing the processes to mount. So most mount, even in a user namespace, is not allowed. Linux capabilities. Everybody know what Linux capabilities are? So back when I was a young pup, the Linux kernel thought, you know, we have root privilege. Root means everybody in this room that's dealt in Unix knows that if you have root, I have everything on the system. Well, the Linux engineers, kernel engineers, decided many years ago that they were going to break apart the power of root. And the first concept of that was a thing called capabilities. So what they did is they got an integer which has 32 bits. And they said, I could break the power of root into 32 different capabilities. And I said, 32 is plenty. We'll never run out. So they started dealing with capabilities, and they looked at certain things. So a capability, for instance, ping. Right? When I do a ping, I need to send a raw IP packet on the network. All right? So that I could basically say, well, the ability to send a raw IP socket, maybe that's one capability. So they created a net raw socket. Another one, do you know that being able to bind to ports in less than 1024 means that you should be trusted? Right? So there's actually, the reason you can't run Apache on port 80 is because if you did, then everybody would trust that it came from a trusted source. Or at least it did in 1969 when Unix was first being developed. All right, so back in those times when there was only 12 computers in the world, if I could bind to a port less than 1024, then I gave full access because, you know, Harvard and MIT could trust that there had to be someone with privilege able to bind to that port. So that's the tradition of why you can't bind to ports in less than 1024. So it turns out that there's a capability that allows you to bind to ports in less than 1024. So set UID, set GID, all sorts of capabilities. So we can actually run most, we can drop most capabilities from a Linux container, and most processes can run very well. They don't need these capabilities. Things like setting capability to set capabilities, the ability to load kernel modules, right? We probably don't want most containers to be able to load kernel modules, to modify the kernel, change the system time on a box. Other ones, the ability to write directly to print case into the kernel, things like that. So these are capabilities that are removed. So as soon as you run a Docker container, these capabilities are removed. But one interesting thing when they designed the 32 capabilities is they basically, the kernel engines are the two things. First of all, they started to run out of capabilities. So what do you do when you run out of capabilities? Do you allocate more? No, you just start piling on existing capabilities. So two capabilities that came up were, the first one was cap net admin. So there is not a cap firewall D, there is not a cap route D. There's not a cap. There's only one cap net raw. So the ability to modify anything to do with the network, the kernel engineer started pouring on to the cap net admin. Turns out we can eliminate this. So we configure the network outside of the container. We configure the network and processes inside of the network cannot. So this allows us to run containers in such a way that I could set up network routing and firewall rules for a container, and I can run a container that only can talk to the internet. I can run a container that can only talk to the internet, and then I could basically run a process that moves packets back and forth. And if anybody here is from the security world, that's called a cross-domain solution. That's MLS inside information. But another one, a huge one, is cap sysadmin. So as you are a kernel engineer and you start to get lazy, and all of a sudden you get a process that needs to be able to do something that you can sit back and say, you know, that sounds like an admin might do that. I don't have to pick another one of those 32 capabilities. I can just grab cap sysadmin. So cap sysadmin became the catch-all. It is root. All right? It's the most powerful capability in the universe. And the reason I say that is it actually has all these capabilities in it. So the ability to mount, which is the most important one here, is actually controlled by cap sysadmin. It has so many capabilities built into cap sysadmin that it takes two pages inside of the include file to define everything that cap sysadmin has. But the unbelievable thing is we can eliminate, for most use cases, cap sysadmin. So we can actually eliminate this one, and this is how we eliminate the ability to mount inside of a container. So if you try to mount inside a container, you will, even if you're running as UID 0, you will be blocked. Namespaces. So namespaces, I always tend to tell people that namespaces are not really a security mechanism. They're just a way of changing a process's worldview of the system. The goal is not necessarily to get you more secure because you use namespaces. But namespaces actually hide a lot of the rest of the operating system. For instance, if you use the PID namespace, if you don't know other processes are running on the system, from your view of the system, all you see is the processes inside of your container. It makes it a lot harder to attack other processes on the system. And similarly, network namespaces I just covered. If I can't see the networks, the other networks that are available, I can't see the internet, it makes it a lot harder to attack. Another security mechanism, a thing called the device C group. So We talked a little bit about mechanisms to attack or protect the attack surface on the kernel. One way is through the kernel file systems being read-only. But another way you attack the kernel or talk to the kernel is through devices. Okay, and everybody knows that because they all have physical devices for the physical disks. You have dev memory. You have all these devices that allow you to actually interact with the kernel. Well, it turns out that we actually can control which devices are made available to the container, and we can block make node. So we can block processes from being able to talk to the devices, so we can take advantage of device. The mechanism for doing this is called device C group. I actually believe this should have been a namespace. I think C group's kind of, I think of C groups as being resource controls, but they built it as a C group. So we can actually define which devices are allowed to be used inside of a container. And the devices that are actually used inside of the container are dev console, dev zero, dev null, dev fuse, dev full, lots of TTYs, dev u random, and dev u random. Those are the only things that are exposed inside of a Docker container out of the box. There is no physical disk device inside of that. There is no dev memory. But it turns out that most processes work real well with just these limited amount of devices. If you try to make node inside of these, one of these other devices, it will be blocked. Also, you can't ship an image with a device already on the image because we mount all the devices as node dev, which means that you're not allowed to use devices on top of the physical disk. So even if you somehow got someone to install a faulty image that had devices on it, the device still wouldn't work. Okay, so now we're going to get into SELinux. Read.
SELinux is a labeling system. Every process has a label. Every file, directory, system object has a label. Policy rules control access
Okay, thank you very much. Hallelujah. Sit down, all right? All right. Everybody understands SELinux, right? It's so easy. It's just a labeling system. There's a label on a process, there's a label on a file. That's it. There's a rule that says whether this label on a process can access that label on a file. That's what SELinux is. It's very similar to discretionary access control. There's a label on the process, the ownership and group. There's a label on the object. There's the ownership and group of the file and the permission flags. If those labels don't match up, you can't access. That's all SELinux is. But if that isn't enough, I gave everybody coloring books. So we're going to delve deeper into the hidden secrets of SELinux. So grab your SELinux coloring book. If you don't have one, I have the pictures here. So, okay, so SELinux is based on a concept of type info. This is what the NSA taught me, by the way. So SELinux is based on the concept of type enforcement. Okay, so the really interesting thing that the NSA did when they first developed SELinux is they actually developed a type enforcement system. So everything is based on type. Every process has a type. So if you look at that really long, ugly label, the third field over is the type field. All right, HTTPD_T. SVERT underscore T is the name of virtual machines. Everybody has a type. But to get it simpler, we're going to talk about the types. So these, we're going to use the process. We have a process called a cat and a process called a dog. Then we have labels. We have types for objects that exist on the file system. Okay, so now we have cat chow and we have dog chow. So these are objects on the file system. And then we write rules. And this is exactly what a rule looks like for SELinux. It says allow the cat to eat the cat chow food and allow the dog to eat the dog chow food. That's exactly, that is almost verbatim what you would write into an SELinux policy. SELinux by default is deny everything. So if I don't have an allow rule, I block it. SELinux kernel will block it. So we write that policy and we have the cat eating the cat chow and we have the dog eating the dog chow and they love it. The cat can ask the kernel for more cat chow and he gets it. But when the dog goes to eat the cat chow, it gets blocked by the kernel. I want you to soak that in for a minute, okay? Everybody got it? You understand type enforcement? Okay, one problem with type enforcement that we're gonna get into, well, let's look a little bit further in type enforcement. So type enforcement protects the host system from the container processes. All right, so my container processes are gonna be running with a label that is not allowed to touch my home directory. It's not allowed to touch root. It's not allowed to touch random content inside a slash var. So the type the type that we run our Docker containers with is actually allowed to read and execute files in slash user. That means so you can mount slash user into the container, but not able to write there. But container processes are only allowed to write to one type. So there's only one type of catch out that a container process can write. So if we look at, we have really ugly names for this, and some of this is historic. But basically, we run Docker itself launches containers, and it launches them as SVERT. The process type is SVERT LXC net T. That means it's SVERT secure virtualization, which is the way we call this technology, LXC because it's Linux containers. And the case we'll use net because we're not blocking any network access to the process. And then we have the only type that this type is allowed to write to is SVERT sandbox file T. So unless I label content on my machine as SVERT sandbox file T, or Docker does that, then the container process, that's the only type it can read and write to. The only type it can write to. It's able to read to other types. The problem with that is if all I have is container processes and one container breaks out, it can attack the other container processes, right? Because all the content for those other container processes use the same type. So in this case, we're looking at multiple dogs who have multiple dog food. So we want to make sure that we have those separated out. MCS enforcement stands for multi-category security. It was based on a former standard called MLS, which is all about things like top secret and secret, which you might have heard a little bit about. But we invented, I worked in a team that invented MCS separation. And really what we did is when we were doing virtualization, the LVM virtualization, authorization, we wanted to use MCS type to make sure one QEMU process cannot attack the other QEMU processes of the other containers. But we have this field, the last field, the fourth field on an SELinux label, and we took advantage of it. And we wrote a new idea of policy separation that basically said the MCS labels have to match. So the label at the end, we label the process and we label the content on disk, and if they don't match, then we deny access. So we have chapter two, or chapter three in the container book, SELinux book. So we have the process labeled FIDO, and we have a process labeled SPOT. So now they're both dogs, so the type enforcement rules are around types, but we've added this MCS label. In this case, we're just using the SPOT analogy, and then we label our content on disk as being dog chow FIDO, and now we dog chow SPOT. And we allow FIDO to eat his food, but if FIDO tries to eat Spot's food, the container, even though it's still dog chow, because the label, the last part of the labels don't match, it gets blocked. This is what MCS enforcement's all about. So MCS enforcement's used for separation of OpenShift, it's used for separation of secure virtualization, and now it's used for separation of containers inside of Docker. MCS protects containers from each other. Container processes can only read and write their own container files. And what that looks like, if you looked at the processes, you'd see the Docker daemon picks out a unique random MCS label. We're using two categories here. So it picks out S0, C1, comma C2. And then it assigns that at container start or container creation time, it actually assigns that MCS label to it. The Docker daemon then guarantees that these labels are unique. Next question, how many containers can I run? By default, we support 500,000 containers running on a Docker system. All right. That made sense for VMs. I don't know if that's going to make sense. We might have to increase the number of containers that a system will support. But right now, with just two categories, we support 500,000. We can always add a third category. So we can actually get that to sort of exponentially grow in the number of containers that we could support. But we have to guarantee uniqueness. The Docker container launches the container, so it labels the content with the MCS label and then launches the container process with the same label. So Docker without SELinux? Okay. Now, for you youngins, there used to be an ad campaign about Tupperware. It's a container, and you used to have to hear this burp, and that would mean that everything is secure inside of it. Okay. But I actually believe that SELinux is the best part of the kernel as far as controlling it. I might be biased. But I think of all the security I've talked about, SELinux is the best one for actually containing the containers. New technology, and some of this technology is right around the corner for actually controlling the container processes, right? The trouble is it's been right around the corner for a very large corner, but it's really, really close. So we're going to talk about SecComp right now. So SecComp, we've been working for the last year to year and a half to get SecComp into Docker. SecComp is now in Docker, except for the user interface to set it up. So SecComp is in libcontainer. It's in the underlyings of it. And hopefully very soon, probably post 1.9, we'll finally have SecComp support. So SecComp, so we're looking again at the attack surface on the kernel. One way you interact with the kernel is through the syscalls. So I basically can make syscalls, open, read, write, different syscalls to the kernel. If I could, on a x86-64 machine, there are 650 syscalls. If a bug in any one of those syscalls allows me to get a root escalation through the kernel, I can take over the host. I can break out of the confinement, I can turn SELinux off, I can do pretty much anything I want if I can get out of those. So as soon as I get a vulnerability in the kernel, I'm hosed. If a syscall is exact. But if I could basically eliminate some of the syscalls, right, then I can shrink the attack surface. I could get that syscall table down from 650 down to x86 32-bit level, which is 325. I could cut the attack surface on the kernel. Do you know why x86 64 has twice as many syscalls as a 32-bit operating system? It's so that it can support 32-bit code on a 64-bit system. How many people in this room are running 32-bit code on their 64-bit systems inside of a Docker container? It was one person who just pulled his hand down. Okay? Nobody. So wouldn't it be cool if I could basically eliminate the entire 32-bit syscall table from my Docker containers? So any vulnerability in a 32-bit syscall table couldn't be attacked? Well, I can do that with SecComp. So SecComp allows you to eliminate, limit the amount of syscalls on the system. So these are some of the syscalls that we're proposing are eliminated. Things like kexec load, open file handle at. That's actually an interesting one. Docker had a vulnerability that it turns out that the inode of slash is easily guessable. An open file at allows me to open the real slash. If I can open up that directory, I can then get the inode of the next one down. So guess what? I was able to break out of Docker containers by taking advantage of open file system at. SELinux blocks it, but nothing else was able to block it. So I could actually get out of the containers using that. Other ones are init module, load kernel modules, obviously, swap on, turning on the swap on and off system, certain sysfs, changing sys controls. So there's lots and lots of syscalls that I can eliminate from the container. But just turning on seccomp inside of a container instantaneously blocks 32-bit syscalls. So we are basically building the capability to blacklist a whole group of syscalls, including all non 64-bit syscalls. So instantaneously, we can cut this table in half. But there's some others I want you to think about. And I know there's people in this room that probably think about this. Block old weird networks. How many people in here are using AppleTalk? There's one guy back there. Okay. DeckNet? NetWare? Those are all supported in the Linux kernel, right? You can still run those things. All right, how much exposure do you think people are using? You're looking at those for their, like, security vulnerabilities. This old, ancient, crufty, right? Another vulnerability one of those vulnerabilities I talked about earlier in virtualization, floppy disk drives. Okay, so the kernel's support for floppy disk drives allowed people to break out of, forget about containers, out of virtualization environment. That's still supported, right? Floppy disk drives. So with seccomp, we can start to eliminate all this old cruft that's still in the Linux kernel. So seccomp hopefully is real, real close. The next one is user namespace. How many people heard of user namespace? How many people are all excited about it? Oh, user namespace, that's going to solve all my problems. Okay. User namespace is probably the most overhyped piece of security tool, all right? And actually, in some ways, it's fixing the wrong problem. So user namespace, the idea of user namespace, and user namespace will be turned on, I believe, in Docker 1.9. And we're gonna, actually, every time I look at it, it's like you. So the way user namespace works is very much like the PID namespace. So I can basically go out and I can grab a random UID off the system, and I can run a container as that root inside that container as that UID. So if you're in PID namespace, you've probably seen, oh, I go into my container and it says it's PID 1, and then you go outside the container and it's really PID 52342, right? So the kernel is sort of lying to you, saying, oh, that's PID 1. In user namespace, I'm going to be able to write, pick, say, UID 5000, and I'm going to say that's root inside of my container. Now, if I break out of the container, the kernel goes and say, hey, you're UID 5000, you're not able to do stuff. But inside the container, inside of your namespaces, you're able to do some privileged operations. So you're able to take those capabilities. So there's like namespace, a user namespace capabilities. So I can have those capabilities, but just while I'm inside of my container. Sounds pretty good, huh? There's a couple of real bad flaws with user namespace. The biggest one, in my opinion, is that there's no file system support. So I map UID 5000 inside of the container, and I bring up my Docker image, and my Docker image has UID 0 files on it. 5000 is not allowed to touch UID 0s. Matter of fact, it looks at it and it sees minus 1. So the kernel basically says any UID that's not mapped into the container now is minus 1. So your container instantly blows up. So now I got to take that image that comes, everybody has images with UID 0 on it, and I got to do a change ownership on all that file. You think that causes copy on write file systems a little headache if I'm going in and changing every single UID? On the file system to match. Now I want to get, remember we talked about, so now I'm basically running a root privilege inside of the container that's separate from a root privilege, you know, it's non-root on the host. So I have a choice here. If I want to run another container I got to pick another UID, so I pick UID 6000. Now I run another container, I got to pick UID 7000. Pick another container, pick 8000. All right. Not only that, but all other UIDs inside of the container are not supported. I have to map every single UID into the container that I'm going to use. So if I want to have my Apache process running as UID 60, I not only have to map in UID 0, I also have to UID 60. So now maybe I'll do 5,000 to 5,060. Or maybe I'll just say, the heck with it, I'll do 5,000 to 6,000. I'm going to map that in the first container. Now I'm going to map 6,000 to 7,000 in the next container. I say, bro, all right. Anybody here ever have problems with NFS UID mappings? Anybody ever have problems with, it's just been a friggin' disaster. It's always been a disaster, and that's what this thing is building. The whole reason user namespace even exists is because we ship software that thinks it has to run as root in order to run inside of containers. All right? Apache doesn't need to run as root. It has nothing to do with it, right? Apache binding to port 80 is the only reason that Apache needs to run as root. But the entire RPM infrastructure or Debian infrastructure assumes that I'm installing to a host operating system. So we actually have to fix the way we package software, and then user namespace would become less interesting because we could start to run these as just random UIDs and not have to do this mapping and stuff. Yes? Right. Well, we've actually experimented. I mean, yeah, there's stuff that we can lie to the, but it's not standardized, right? It'd be really nice if we just started to rethink the way we package software. So that, yeah, he's talking about fake root, which basically takes out the shared libraries from underneath RPM and says, oh, UID inside of this container is actually Dan Walsh's UID. And there's other things that do it. But there's other activities that happen in like post-install scripts, like talking to systemd and saying, reload the container on boot. So there's lots of stuff other than just the UID problem. So user namespace is showing up in Docker 1.9, and all they've done for user namespace in 1.9 is they're actually mapping root to non-root. So all containers will run with the same UID mapping. So it's really giving you sort of what the type enforcement in SELinux, or theoretically what the type enforcement in SELinux is giving you, right? So it's good, and I sadly was the one that suggested that, and now I regret I did it because I've looked at what they're trying to do. Docker is going to allow you to set up this on your daemon, and when you pull down an image from the Docker I/O, it's going to go through and fix the UIDs inside of the image before it gets put down on disk. If you do a Docker push, it's going to go through the UIDs and remap them back to zero before it pushes. That's what's coming in 1.9. And all you're going to get is Docker UID map to it. All right? How about if I volume mount into the container? If I volume mount into the container, a root file is not going to be able to use. So I'm going to have to go out and change those UIDs. How about if I run a privileged container? When I run privileged container, it turns off all privileges on the container. If I've remapped root to non-root inside of the container, now I'm running real root inside of the container because I don't want to have this user namespace, but all my files are owned by UID 5000. I go and create a new file inside the top of an image, and now it's got a UID 0 with the 5000. So you can see why I say it's a little shaky. So don't get too excited about user namespace. My team is trying to work on ways to make user namespace more valuable, but in my opinion, what we really need to do is fix our packaging problem. So distributions have to start to think about packaging software to run in containers, not packaging software to run as privileged processes on the host operating system. One question, actually, a competitor to OpenShift, Cloud Foundry, beats up RHEL all the time because RHEL did not turn on user namespace by default. In 7.2, user namespace will be turned on. So user namespace has actually been in the RHEL kernel right from the beginning, right from RHEL 7. What hasn't been allowed is basically unshare. The syscall into the kernel has not been allowed to turn on user namespace. Kind of good thing that's happened too, because there's been a few CVEs that have happened since RHEL 7 shipped, but we've decided that we're going to allow user namespace, especially with lining up with Docker starting to support it. So RHEL 7, as of 7.2, which comes out in November, will have user namespace, but it only be enabled as root. You have to be privileged to turn it on. The goal of Eric Biederman, who works for Red Hat, is to allow it to be turned on by non-root. I think that's a mistake. He has different opinion with me, but basically, his goal is to allow anybody to run a container on the system without requiring privilege. He believes it's secure enough, but. So that's the end of user namespace. What I don't cover in this presentation is a new security mechanism that's been introduced by Intel. So Intel came to ContainerCon, and they've actually been working with us a little bit over the last few months to basically they were optimized a kernel. Imagine a kernel per container. Sounds a little like virtualization, right? But what Intel's been able to do, and they call it Clear Linux or Clear Linux containers, is they want to add a really quick, small little kernel, Linux kernel, that can boot up very quick. And they want to be able to boot a Docker container within 200 milliseconds. And they've been able to shrink down the way the kernel works. But if I can use a kernel on top of KVM, I start to get closer to that, to my duplex. So what we're investigating now is the possibility of running containers with their own individual kernels. It actually adds some other nice features than that. I could have a different kernel for my containers than I have for my host. So from RHEL 7, as that RHEL 7 kernel ages, I might want to have a newer kernel that runs with my containers. But actually running a container environment with its own kernel brings other problems in that it gives you too good a separation. In a lot of cases, you want to have some sharing of namespaces between containers. So for instance, Kubernetes takes advantage of a thing called pods, where they run multiple multiple containers that all share the same network devices. All right, so as soon as you go to a KVM type environment with your kernel, you know, you get into sort of this KVM hassle of, you know, you can't share IPCs between them, you can't share. So in a lot of cases, I think in the future we're going to have the ability to run a container with its own kernel, and then we can really tighten the SELinux controls and get down to almost as good a security as pure virtualization. And that's called Linux container. I got to fix my slides to put that in. And that was heavily shown. It was actually shown and demonstrated. It was pretty cool at that ContainerCon at the last LinuxCon. So the chapter four, how do pigs furnish the apartment? Okay, and this gets back to CMO's thing about running random crap from the internet. At this point, I'd like to play some horror music as we get towards Halloween. Anybody here remember Linux 1999? Any other old farts besides me in the room? Okay, a few old ones in the back. Linux 1999, the horror. Okay, in Linux 1999, where did you get your software? Okay, everybody's screaming out things, okay? Well, my opinion is you went to Alta Vista and to yahoo.com and you Googled for a way to get your software because Google didn't quite exist yet. And then you would say something like, hey, I found it on rpmfind.net. And then you would download it and install it on your system and you would be happy. At which point, someone in your company would come to you and say, hey, I just read a document about the latest zlib vulnerability. For some reason, zlib was the number one vulnerability for like 10 years straight, or 2 or 3 years straight. There was always a new zlib vulnerability. And he would say to you, how many copies of the zlib vulnerability do we have running in our environment? And you would say, I ain't got a clue. Okay, because you ran and grabbed random crap from the internet and installed in your machine. Okay. Red Hat came to the rescue in 1999, and they developed Enterprise Linux. Okay. I like to tell people the reason Red Hat makes money off of Linux is because we do the crappy part of Linux. All right. We do things like support a kernel, RHEL 5 kernel, that is like 10 years old. Right. Most of you guys work for companies, and I bet on your laptops, if you're dealing, oh, the latest Fedora, the latest Rawhide, the latest Ubuntu, okay? But your company is running its web server on a RHEL 4 system or a RHEL 5 system, and you pay us lots of money to try to make sure that thing doesn't crumble from the weight of its age. That's what you're paying for, us to do the crappy part. So Red Hat stabilized the environment. We got you the security updates for the kernel. We got you, we watched for things. We made sure we had certified applications. We worked with third parties and had them figure out not to use 100 versions of zlib inside of their programs, illegally copied down. Red Hat Enterprise Linux solved the problem, certified software and hardware platforms. So what are you doing now? People have no idea of the quality of the software that they're running in their containers. Nobody does. Anybody hear the report that Docker had a little black eye a couple months ago. All right, at Docker.io, they claimed, I don't know, it was 40,000, let's say there's 40,000 images up there. A security team went on and downloaded all 40,000 images and then ran a security scan on them, and they found 30% of the images were vulnerable. I hope I get to that part. Let's see. Okay. Yeah, let's jump ahead to this. Containers move the security responsibility from the operator to the developer. So as we move forward with this, the DevOps model is heavily weighted towards the dev side. Everybody has to understand that. How many people in this room are developers? How many are operators? Okay. Do developers care about security? No. Do developers care about anything other than the latest, coolest, newest thing? Do anybody want to work on a RHEL 5 kernel that is 10 years old, backporting stuff? No. Ah, too bad. I had a job offer here available to somebody, but developers don't care about security. Developers want to do cool new stuff. I'm a developer. I understand the mentality. Operators get fired for, the operator that was running the system that got hacked at Marshall's that gave out 30,000 credit card data to somebody, it was probably a developer's bug. But the operator who didn't update the security on the system is probably the one that got fired. So operators are on the line to make sure their systems are secure. They care about security. So as we move to, operator is out sitting out there watching for the latest vulnerabilities. He's reading about shell shock. He's reading about stuff. And the DevOps, they're not caring about shell shock. I don't work on Bash. How many here work on Bash? Wow, a lot of Bash people here. I mean, you use Bash, but do you actually write code in Bash? You support the platform? Okay, how many people here have built a Docker container? A lot of it. How many have pushed a Docker container to Docker.io? A few less. How many, when shell shock broke, went and rebuilt your container to make sure it had a fresh version of shell shock, I mean, of Bash in it, so they didn't have shell shock? We got two that actually did that. Three. Okay? So shell shock comes out. You're out there developing Hadoop, right? Cool. I'm developing Hadoop. I download a Ubuntu image, or I download a RHEL image, and I build my Hadoop on it. Oh, yeah, Hadoop, great name. I have no idea what Hadoop is, but all right. So I put that on it, and it just so happens I grabbed an image that had a version of Bash in it. I pushed it out to Docker.io, and now I go off to work on the latest, greatest thing, right? Elasticsearch, maybe, something cool. Do I go back when a vulnerability happens? Do I even hear about it? Do I even understand that my container had the vulnerability in it? No. So Docker.io goes out and gets examined by this company, and they found 30% of all containers, images available at Docker.io had the vulnerabilities, had known CV vulnerabilities on it. This is the code we're downloading and installing on our systems. The reason this is not a Docker problem, it had nothing to do with the Docker problem. Do you guys blame GitHub if there's a bug in a piece of code that's sitting on GitHub that someone downloads and compiles and installs in their machine? Do we blame them for that? No. Docker is the same thing. All Docker is a store that you can upload things to and allow other people to share it. So Docker's job is not to make sure they're working on it now. They're trying to fix this problem, but they can't. Right? These images, the whole Docker model is based on a developer uploading his software. And that software is the only thing. It's a unit that's going to be run on the system. So developers care about that. So what happens when it is in Docker.io 10 years from now, instead of having 40,000, you have hundreds of thousands of these images running all over your huge companies. Bloomberg has hundreds of thousands of these things running out there. You're not even going to know where these things are. The developers are going to be long gone. Right? They're going to be off to working for Silicon Valley making oodles of money. They're going to be gone. So how do you, who's going to be in charge of making it? So think about these things. So you need to have software that comes from a trusted spot. You trust developers to fix security in images?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know if this is going to work, but we'll try it. Okay, for the youngins in the crowd. I'll start it up. and we'll explain who these people are. I can get this working. Some of the old people understand who the... So this is Ronald Reagan. He used to be president of the United States. That guy next to him is called Gorbachev. He was president of the Soviet Union. Okay, so what was happening here is at that time when I was young and fresh into programming, there used to be these nuclear weapons, and they're still there. But there used to be, I think the US could like destroy the world 700 times over, and the Soviet Union could only do it 400 times over. So they got together and they said, let's destroy some of these nuclear weapons. And I think it's probably now we can do it 50 times and they can do it 25 times. But you know, there are less nuclear weapons. But the whole idea was, you know, they were going to destroy their weapons, we were going to destroy our weapons, but neither one of them trusted it, so they had to trust but verify. So the idea when you go to containers is you trust your developers to do the right thing, but you want tools to be able to examine the containers and examine them to make sure that they're up to date, that they have security fixes, and that's what Red Hat's going to be doing. By the way, this guy over here, he was the president of the United States too. That's George Bush, Nancy Reagan. Oh, the white hair in the corner there is Barbara Bush. So I don't know who the other two are. Oh, that's the, yeah, she's the wife of Gorbachev, right? So what happens when the next shell shock hits? So I already went through this one. So here's my next sales pitch. Red Hat Enterprise Linux certified images. Okay, so what Red Hat's trying to do is build up a certified image. Same thing we did for previous. We want to build up a trusted source for images going forward. We're working with third parties, we're working with vendors, and we're going to basically allow them to build on top of Red Hat Enterprise Linux, and then we will build tools that will be able to scan it. So we built tools now. We're about to announce it at RHEL 7.2 timeframe, atomic scan tool. An atomic scan tool will actually go through all your containers in your environment and examine them for security vulnerabilities. Okay, it will actually examine them for configuration. We're going to use our CVE data, our open SCAP data, stuff we developed for the government, to allow you to scan all your containers. Guess what's going to happen when it scans an Ubuntu container? What's going to happen when it scans a BusyBox container? What's going to happen when it scans a Fedora container or a CentOS container? It's going to say, I have no idea. So the only thing we can scan for security vulnerabilities is stuff we ship, stuff that we have code that can examine. So the only thing we're going to be able to examine is RHEL content. So as you're sitting out there saying, oh, I'm just going to go grab random distributions from anywhere on the internet and run them on my host, think about that. Ubuntu can only scan Ubuntu. RHEL can only do RHEL. Nobody else can make a security claim about anything else in your system. So as people go out there running around saying, I'm grabbing random content, random distributions, and installing on the system, when it gets to be 7 or 8 years old, who are you going to trust to make sure that code's all right? So I work with this fabulous artist. Her name is Maureen Duffy. She drew all the cartoons and in the comic book, and she refused to give me this cartoon. But actually, the original cartoon I wanted him on a spigot rotating over a fire with the wolf turning it. And the problem is the coloring books get in the hands of little kids. She has a very young daughter, so she refused. So if you look at your coloring book, you won't see this picture in it, but she finally succumbed and gave me it and told me not to use it, and of course, I use it. Any questions?
So we'll use the mics up here for anyone who wants to ask. Please just come in, alternate sides, back and forth. Da-da-da. If you're all thinking, maybe you want to propose the first question you want to answer.
Okay. I guess I got to give away something?
No. That's really, right now it's a question and answer. If you want to ask, I'm saying if there's anything that wasn't in the talk, maybe you can get people... Yep. A second to line up and ask their questions. Excuse me, if you're going to ask a question, can you please go up to the microphone so everyone can hear you? I mean, you're actually, you've got a great voice, but it's for the recordings also.
What's the latency impact of running SELinux? You talk about all this good stuff behind it.
I've been hearing the SELinux question about latency for so many friggin' years. Just about nothing. Okay, the latest tools to examine it. You can build use cases where SELinux really sucks for performance, but in most use cases, it actually affects nothing as far as security. Matter of fact, things like namespaces, network namespace is probably going to affect your latency 1,000 times as much as running with SELinux. I think something that handles money should not be secured. So yeah.
I don't know if you know the answer to that. I actually have two questions, if that's okay.
Sure.
And I don't know if you know the answer to the first one or not. Do you know if Intel's virtualization technology, I think Clear Containers is what it's called?
I already talked about that.
I'm sorry.
Have you heard of Linux? Can you name the Intel's software?
Oh, I'm sorry.
You get a prize if you can name
okay.
it. Clear Containers.
Did I get it right? Okay, whatever. Yeah. Anyway, do you know if that incurs the same overhead as traditional virtualization?
Yes.
It does, okay.
Yeah, it's using KVM. Basically, it's just a kernel running on top of KVM.
All right. My second question is, if you're only using root to build containers, does the user namespaces help in securing your build platform?
All right, let's go back. Actually, let's talk a little bit more about Linux containers. So I was a little flippant towards you. So it does use KVM, but if you look at traditional virtualization environments, you know, you're running a whole operating system inside of the virtualization. So there is going to be more, you know, stuff happening. So you're running systemd, you're running udev, you're running all this other stuff. So there is going to be a lot more going on in a traditional VM. So I probably need to clarify that. Your other question was, I just meant to block it out of my head.
If you're only wanted to use user namespace mapping.
Build systems using user namespace. Yeah, I mean, theoretically they would, but the problem is you need to map all potential users' UIDs into the container. So if you basically installed a RPM package that did installed Apache and goes out and does a user add and basically Fred, you have to map a range of UIDs. So you theoretically, you could map UID 0 to 1,000 into the container as 6,000 to 7,000. Then you would get a more secure user.
I understand that, but that would only be important if you're really set on having Apache run as root on port 80, right? Because you can remap the port that the container listens to outside to something else inside.
Right, but why aren't I just running the container as UID 3,427 and running Apache inside of it? Why do I need user namespace to do that?
Oh, no, I don't think you do. I just was wondering if it would be useful for the building and securing the building.
Yeah, I mean, building's a tough problem, right now Docker containers run as locked down as possible. But yeah, user namespace will give us another tool. Again, it's not going to be perfect. So when you do a Docker build, we're wrapping with as much security as we can. So Docker build and Docker run use the same level of security. So the SELinux, the capabilities, all the stuff I talked about happens in a Docker run.
Right, thank you.
And Docker build. Yep.
We were talking about RHEL and community services, but what about CentOS, which is actually RHEL?
It is?
It is. Oh. And the fact that Red Hat made a deal with the CentOS people
we hired them.
Huh?
We hired them.
Hired them, okay, right. Whichever, but you're still cooperating, so why not?
Oh, we have a rice wall between us.
Uh-huh. Okay, but wouldn't that also mean that CentOS can be just as secure if...
No.
Why not?
Because we don't do the things we do for CentOS that we do for RHEL. But we don't have content that looks at the CentOS content.
It's the same, it's the same system.
It isn't. it has a totally different build system. It has a totally different... We hired let's talk about CentOS a little bit, so I'll give you a little history. So we actually hired the CentOS developers, or a bunch of the CentOS developers, for CentOS to become a new upstream for the Red Hat layered products. So you look at, you know, so traditional upstream for Red Hat is Fedora. Okay, Fedora changes constantly. So if you wanted to build, say, Atomic Host, or you wanted to build tools like Red Hat OpenStack, things like that, we wanted a more stable platform for the third layer of products to build on top of. So the reason we do CentOS now is we actually, CentOS is both an upstream and a downstream for RHEL. So now you're going to see things like CentOS getting its own newer version of the kernel and getting, you know, so CentOS is going to get somewhat out of, there's going to be the traditional CentOS that's just RHEL rebuilds on top of CentOS, but there's going to be also CentOS upstream, okay? So it's going to get kind of weird.
So CentOS is going to be a Fedora type of thing?
It's a stable Fedora. Okay, so it's an upstream for layered products, right? So Fedora, you know, if I'm building Red Hat OpenStack platform, the open source version of Red Hat's OpenStack, I need a stable platform to develop it on. I can't be constantly changing and worrying about changes in the Linux upstream Linux kernel. So I need a stable kernel. So that's why we did it. At least that's my understanding of why we did it. But we're not saying, Red Hat is never going to say the CentOS is the same as RHEL. Okay, so CentOS is a rebuild of RHEL with stuff changed. All right, okay.
Hi. A bit of a comparative OS question. You mentioned a few different sort of current and future security APIs in the Linux kernel.
Yeah.
How do those sort of map on to, compare to, partially or completely to the TAME API that's being developed by OpenBSD, if you're familiar with it?
Not really.
Okay.
But
it sounded like it was mostly.
Basically, we support whatever is in the Linux kernel.
Sure.
So any security mechanism that gets it. So there's been traditionally, you know, lots and lots of people that have done security stuff outside the Linux kernel and never gotten the stuff merged into the Linux kernel. So if it doesn't get merged into upstream, we're not going to support it.
I was merely asking because it seems like there's a ton of stuff going on in Linux that is sort of overlapping and sort of not, whereas I look at sort of other projects and they make
right.
Sort
I mean,
of conceptual
it's,
sense.
I hear that there was some kind of fork of the Linux kernel that happened today. I heard rumor of that today, but to do more security, you know, so like the microkernel type concept, there's the, I forget it, I'm blocking on the names right now. They've always had this isolation kernel and never got their patches into the upstream kernel. So there are lots of features. We're interested in those, but we need to see them. We're never going to support a non-Linux kernel. So
of course, it was more of a comparative question as opposed to a one's
right.
coming.
So I don't really know that much about that platform. Yep.
So pardon me, this question may not be well formed. One of the things that I've noticed in the Google C or the Google C++ style guide is that they are disallowing the use of namespaces, which is something that you said reduced the attack space for...
I think they're talking about a different use of the word namespace.
Okay.
Yeah, so namespaces in C++ are different than kernel namespaces.
Okay.
Okay, so...
And one is some Docker containers, they rely on outside parts of the operating system to mount like configuration files.
Correct.
Can those ever be secure, or are they inherently insecure because they're already accessing the file system outside of the container?
Yeah, so we've introduced the concept of what we call super privileged containers, which are basically, I call it the opposite talk of what I just gave, which is how do I allow my files inside of a container to break out and manage the system. So usually if you're, you know, there's only so much we can do to control the process. If you want to mount in, say, slash into the container, we fully support that and allow you to do that, and that's what we call a super privileged container. But you can't do security on a lot of things. So it depends on the use case of what you're mounting in. One traditional thing is I always tell people, if you can talk to the Docker socket, you have full root on the system. So if you read my blog at all, talking to just allowing a process. If you guys run Docker socket with the Docker group, and then you put your username in the Docker group, that's worse than giving sudo with no password. Okay? You have full control. The reason and you can go home and try this, you can do a docker dash dash privileged dash v slash slash host, run a container, any container in the universe, and then do chroot slash host, and you are root on the system, and there's no log of you ever doing it. Okay? As soon as you stop the Docker daemon, all trace of you ever doing that goes away. So giving someone access to the root. So usually when people come to me and they say, if I do this, is that okay? And I'm like, you know, it all depends on what you're trying to do. So volume mounting in stuff into containers is often fine to do. Matter of fact, that's most of the way we, you know, write to the containers. But if you're volume mounting in Etsy Shadow, you know, SELinux will block it, but you know, potentially you're going to give away the system. Yes.
I'm sorry, I had one other. RHEL 6, Docker 1.7's last version or whatever.
Oh, isn't that
so
sad?
Does that mean that RHEL 6 will never be really secure?
That's what
Docker?
It means. Okay, let's talk about that. So they bring up a good point. Okay, so one problem with the containers, they all use the kernel. Okay, eventually as we move down time, the kernel gets better and better. It gets new features. RHEL, the kernel stays old. Okay, so slowly but surely, the RHEL kernel, the RHEL 7 kernel was based on, I mean, RHEL 6 kernel is what, 5 years old now? All right, so the certain kernel features that aren't, that containers start to need, that is not in the old kernel. And so therefore, not all container environments will run with an old kernel, all right? So that's why Red Hat instantaneously said we will never support RHEL 6 for containers. We've had an operating system for 18 months, I'll call RHEL 7, use it, okay? Docker decided that they were gonna support it because they knew better than Red Hat how to support Red Hat software, okay? And guess what they did? There was constant on GitHub, hey, I had Dan, can you come look at this RHEL 6 problem? Hey, I had Dan, can you come and look at this RHEL 6? And I said, no, I can't because you're using a friggin' old kernel. All right. So we actually have a problem in RHEL 7, is eventually the RHEL 7 kernel, which is now 18 months old or probably 2 years old, is probably going to age out. And we have to figure out, Red Hat has to figure out how we can handle moving new kernels into old RHELs. All right. So we, you know, potentially, you know, when RHEL 7 kernel is 3 years old, hopefully we'll have a RHEL 8 kernel that we might be able to backport onto RHEL, not backport, but to actually support containers. So they might actually, Red Hat might have to break its, you know, long-term guarantee that that we never backport the kernel. We actually do it for real-time kernels now. We backport newer kernels. So we might have to do that for containers. But the real problem is we're never going to do that for a RHEL 6. So we're never going to get a RHEL 6 kernel that runs. So RHEL 6 is out of the question. Okay?
Great talk and amazing picture books. How does all of this relate to my choice of cloud container providers, like AWS has Container Engine and Google has Google Cloud Engine?
I don't work for them, so. Again, you got to rely. I think we covered all the different things you have to concern of. If you trust the container platform from Google or from Amazon, it's probably pretty good, and you can run your containers on it. If you're going to run containers on top of it, again, think about the other things we talked about. What are you going to run inside the containers? What kind of security is Amazon providing? Are they using SELinux for the separation of the Docker containers? What are they using? All right, so when you go to a vendor, now you can go out and get a Docker RHEL 7, you actually get RHEL 7 Atomic Host, which is the platform that we've built to run containers, just to run containers, and you can run that in your Amazon, or you can get an Amazon. I don't even know if Amazon's running native containers yet. I know that I think they've announced something a while ago, but I don't know if it's currently available. I have no idea what's underneath those containers. I can tell you some horror stories about some stuff that Amazon has done in the past, but we'll wait till a quiet moment because I might someday want to work for Amazon if, you know, Red Hat goes away. So I don't want to have them recording me bad-mouthing them. So, yes.
First of all, thanks very much. It was very informative. You mentioned you collaborated with Intel for a bit. Can you elaborate on that? Can I ask questions for that, or can't you disclose any on that?
I can disclose. I'd talk about anything.
Okay. So. Well, you mentioned especially that they're trying to optimize the boot up time or getting it set up.
That's all in the public. So if you go to clearlinux.com, you'll find out everything that they've done.
Okay.
What's
the incentive behind that, though? Like, I imagine it like a virtual machine. I boot that up once, and it's
so think about what time. Intel's goal in this all is. What's Intel do? They build chips. So what do they want to do? They want to make sure you use their chips. So if they can get more security into the running on Intel, guess what they don't support right now? AMD. So the CLEAR-Linux containers only runs on Intel platforms, not on AMD. So that's I mean, Intel, and I think part of it is every company in the universe right now sees everything's Docker and everything's containers. So Intel sat back and said, hey, what are we doing about this? And so that's what they're doing. But I always color my vision of Intel as just how can they sell more hardware. I think they want to get to the point where they could start. They would like to get to the point where you could have a secure boot up. So you could boot up, say, to the RHEL atomic host to a certain point where everything is secure, and then when you start launching containers, we could basically say the entire, and all that's tied into the Intel chipset for, you know,
And
as fast as possible, yeah. And it's basically, they want to sell hardware.
Great talk, first of all. Yeah. In regards to the Docker user group being able to CH root, would that pretty much, anyone who's in the Docker user group pretty much override user namespace?
Can they override? We don't have user namespace yet. User namespace would, if I can run, dash dash privilege means turns off all security. If Docker doesn't turn off user namespace with dash dash privilege, I think they're breaking what dash dash privilege does. And user namespace, theoretically, you could do that. Anyways, when we look at talking to the Docker daemon, I think what Docker is sort of concentrating now is moving role-based access control into the swarm. So that they want to, we've had an open, us and an Israeli company are both trying to get role-based access control into talking to the Docker daemon. Docker has basically ignored our pull requests, and they've basically gone radio silent on it. I think that's because I don't think it's anything nefarious. I just don't think they care at that level. They really want to build into the orchestration level. So similar in OpenShift, we have role-based access control. Kubernetes has the same problem, by the way. If you can talk to Kubernetes directly, basically can own an operating system. So we're probably going to put effort into Kubernetes to do role-based access control in there, and just leave it that Docker daemon is you have to be root to talk to Docker daemon, at least on our platforms. Yep.
Dan, great talk. You've accomplished so much over the years with security and Linux. How did it all start? How did you get into security? It could be short since it's off.
My history prior to Red Hat, I worked for a digital equipment corporation. I actually worked on, I started working on AltaVista. Started working on Project Athena way back in, everybody hear of Project Athena? Okay, a few of the older guys does, but that's where Kerberos, X-Windows System, things like that. It was a digital equipment corporation and IBM funded a huge research effort at MIT back in the early 1980s to build a distributed operating system. That was the Athena project. It was called the MIT Athena. And I worked on DEC Athena, which was Digital Equipment Corporation's effort to move it in. So I started working on Kerberos and stuff like that very early when I was in my mid-20s. I worked for Paul Cormier at the time. Paul Cormier, if you don't know, is the head of all engineering at Red Hat. So I've worked with Paul Cormier pretty much my entire career. I've always followed him around, and our careers evolved similar career paths since then. But so Paul is the boss, the big cheese, and I'm still just an engineer, real happy to be still an engineer. But we went from there. So I worked in DEC Athena. I went to the AltaVista group. We did the first firewall at the White House. So I worked on firewall technology. I worked on VPN technology. We built one of the first VPNs on top of Unix and actually at top of VMS, believe it or not. When Paul left he left Digital/Compaq. So Compaq had bought out Digital. He went to a company called HackerShield. So it was a startup. I went to HackerShield. 1 month later, HackerShield got sold out, and I got a bottle of beer. So that was my first startup. We got bought by a company, BindView, and what we were doing there was intrusion detection, basically figuring out if you had vulnerabilities in your network, using hacker tools to attack it. So I went to work for BindView for a couple of years. BindView is now owned by Symantec, bought out BindView. BindView used to, I did the Unix parts of BindView, and I got laid off on BindView for on a Friday, and I started working at Red Hat on a Monday. And I actually worked at Red Hat for about a year before the NSA and Red Hat decided to get together to work on SELinux. And they went through all the, there was probably 500 Red Hat employees, and they said, who has security in the background? And my name popped up. So I got the booby prize for working with SELinux, which I thoroughly enjoyed. But I've been, so that's how I got into SELinux and process separation. So that's my career in a nutshell. Yeah. Yep.
You mentioned Docker was gating some pull requests. I'm wondering, do you see that as an issue that one company is blocking pull requests from the whole community, And do you see any?
This is video, so help that. I want to get in trouble with Docker.
Do you see anything in the open container? Okay, I can.
Yes,
yeah,
so
open container.
So no. I'm joking. Okay. So every company that you look here has a bias. So Docker invented really cool technology. I think the most important thing they developed is standardized a container format that can be used for downloading containers, right? All this technology existed outside of Docker. It's existed for a long time. I've been working on this technology for a real long time, but it never took off the way it did with Docker. So what Docker did is they made it friggin' easy. So because of that, Docker has a huge advantage in controlling it. Docker, so some pull requests that we've gotten up to Docker, we feel that they have not acted as well as we would want. What a shock. There are reasons for that. And I get frustrated at times with Docker, but I actually like Docker. I like Docker, I like CoreOS. All right, it's always good to challenge the open source community and build. This is why we've kicked the ass of every single Unix company out there, right? It's always new innovative ideas. Same thing with why we're kicking Microsoft's butt right now, and Microsoft suddenly is jumping in on the Docker bandwagon. But yeah, it does get frustrating dealing with Docker and you know, I have my own ideas of why they don't accept certain pull requests. What happened back in the springtime is there was a lot of pressure, I believe, exerted on, I wasn't privy to any of this pressure, was put on Docker to open up some of their technology so that they actually have the open container format. So open container effort came out of Docker, and Docker released the open container format, and partially that was pressure from CoreOS, because CoreOS had standardized on the AppC spec. So I think CoreOS did a tremendous job at defining what a container platform, a container image should look like. Docker opened their format, and I'm really, really hoping that open container and AppC will slam the two things together, because our biggest nightmare at Red Hat is that we end up with RPM and Debian again. We don't want to have two container formats going forward. We want to have the standard image that everybody can just agree on. And that image then could be run by systemd and spawn. It could be run by Rocket. It could be run by Docker. It could be run by runc. So one of the things Docker also did is they opened up libcontainer runc. Libcontainer is a Go bindings for launching containers, launching namespaces, SELinux, and all the security stuff I talked about in C group. So that's all written in Go language. And they also developed a thing called runc, which is a little tool that takes a JSON file and launches a container. So they've opened up those two things, and now there's lots of contributions going into those, and they're no longer controlled. They're actually under LinuxCon, so the container format. So there's more people have more control over those two things. I still think I think Docker is a great company. I think that they're doing a nice job of getting us all thinking. I wish they'd take more of my patches, but what a shock, okay? So we're constantly working with them. I have the same problem. I have a problem with an upstream called systemd, okay? And guess what? They work with me. So there's certain people that I wish would, I'm actually going, systemdconf is coming up in November, I think November 9th, I'm going out to Berlin, and there's this big, the first initial systemdconf, and I'm giving a talk called Docker systemd, can we just get along? And so I deal with Leonard Pottering on this side, and I deal with Solomon Hikes on this side, and those two guys don't like their other's technologies too much. And I'm stuck in the middle trying to work on it. But yeah, I mean, at one company having this kind of power is tough, but I work for Red Hat, right? So we have a lot of power too, so it's not, and I don't want to give up our power either. So I respect that they have this power, but if they go too far, I think other things will happen. But Red Hat, we're not going to, we're stuck in a position we don't want to be, we want to be helpers of open source communities. Right? That's sort of what Red Hat traditionally has helped open, is sponsoring open source. So we don't want to crap on any open source effort. Closed source, you want to talk about Oracle? Oh boy, we'll get into that. So.
No, I think we've got enough on tape to keep you...
unemployed?
No, keep you on your toes, right? We'll send you send us the checks, we'll send you the photos. question and answer time. So we're here at trivia. You have your questions prepared?
No.
Okay, fine and dandy.
So here are the rules, just quickly. For anyone who wants one of the things or doesn't want to spoil it for everyone else, just raise your hand and I'll do the calling. I will try to get to everyone in different questions to try to get different views. It's a big audience. But you'll get asked a question, you will raise your hand, you will get called on. If you are right, you get a thing. If you are not, someone else gets called on. Please don't shout out your answers. It really upsets people when...
Oh, you answered it?
Yeah, you don't get the book for calling out. The guy who got called on gets it, or girl, or whatever. So take it away. Okay, question number one.
Question number one is, should they raise their hand now or not? All right. What does MCS stand for?
Up here.
Oh, wait.
Multi-category
security.
Yes. And come on up and pick a book, yeah. Taking notes is one way to do this, for sure. Yeah. Next question?
Okay, we'll stay in that same vein. What is the other kind of policy that SE Linux enforces besides MCS separation?
You and the cross, the 3D pattern.
Oh, you just answered. I said the other thing other than multi-category security. Type enforcement, yes.
All right. If he says yes, you got it. Come on up.
All right, we'll go a little bit harder. What version of Docker will support user namespace?
I saw your hand up first.
Everybody knows. 1.9 is correct.
Go on and get it. Do you have to return the book if it doesn't appear?
Okay.
Everyone's thinking that.
What is the new operating system that Red Hat is supporting in addition to RHEL?
Your hand was going up first.
Nope.
Who's next? Who else wants? In the back, sir?
But I can't give it to you.
Okay. I'm going to give you in the back a chance.
Nope.
Didn't we just do that?
I must say it's a hard one. Yeah. What's the name of the new operating system that Red Hat is supporting for running?
In the back next to the camera? No. Okay, you rescind that. All right. I'm sorry. I was calling you.
Nope.
Brian.
He was real close. The first guy that answered, he missed one word in the name. Yeah, one more word.
Thing.
Begins with H. What was that? Atomic host.
Okay, well, I'm gonna cancel that one though, because that's like everyone participated.
Everybody, that was a
I'm so sorry. I don't know who to call on for that.
That was a pretty
in all fairness.
One. Okay. What percentage of Docker IO was vulnerable?
30.
Did you pick him?
Yes, I'm sorry. That was okay. I had a handout.
Yes.
Yes.
We used the MAPA. I got to say.
All right. We can go two more questions
Name the two namespaces that provide some form of security besides user namespace. Sorry,
right here.
C groups. Nope.
You over there? Yes, you.
Yep. Yes, one.
You gonna make it two questions?
Nope.
Sure. Go ahead.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Okay, ready?
Go ahead.
What site did I put up to tell you to stop disabling SE Linux?
In the back over there.
Yes.
All right. And at this point, you can do one more question, or you can do three more, or anything in between that you're feeling like.
Okay, let's see. What is my Twitter name?
Actually, I saw your hand going up first over here.
Yeah.
It's up to you if you want to do any more. We can call it, or we have two more things. It's how you're feeling.
You want me to give away a Ubuntu book?
You can take it home if you want.
I'm done.
All right. Everyone will be at the bar. Oh, I did announce, where's the bar again today? I always forget the name of this new place. The, what's it called again? The Stockhouse, 23rd Street. The Storehouse. The Storehouse, 23rd Street off of 6th Avenue.